Welcome everyone to this really special occasion where we're celebrating the life work of a remarkable friend and contributor to our last century and this century in a way that we'll explore during this weekend. Stan Grof just turned 80 years old this month, exactly one week ago, and we thought this would be a great occasion to come to Esalen, the home of our, really the place that shaped, played such a large role in, it cradled so much of the contribution that Stan and then Christina, who joined him here, was able to make to our world. And so we're really grateful to be doing it here at Esalen, grateful to be sharing it with you special people who've come here. I see people all the way from Sweden who've made it. And I'd like to let Stan have his own welcome.
Well, good evening, everybody. I'd like to join Rick in welcoming to this kind of workshop celebration combination. This was Rick's idea, and I'd like to thank you. Now we'll be talking about my work, but for the last 36 years, it was actually work of Christina and myself. So, can you please stand up? Okay, in many ways, you know, it was so interwoven that in some instances it was difficult to say where it was coming from. We have developed a whole topic breathwork together. We have spent years traveling together, giving workshops all over the world. We have jointly organized a number of ITA conferences, International Transpersonal Association conferences. And Christina had a major role in the development of the concept of spiritual emergency that we're kind of jointly experiencing for many, many years. And then also bringing somehow together transpersonal psychology with the addictions field. When she was celebrating her 50th birthday, we were doing a cruise on the bay with a group of friends, and there was Roger Walsh there, and we talked about Christina. He's like, he doesn't know anybody else who managed to use personal crisis in a way that it sort of created some helpful context for other people experiencing similar things. So this is both the spiritual emergency and the addiction. So I would like to use this as appreciating everything that you have contributed to my life personally.
Structural housekeeping things so that we're all on the same page to start with. How many people, is there anybody that is here at Esalen for the first time? Wonderful. Welcome. That's great. This is an initiation. I'll just say our timing, first of all. Tonight is 8:30 until 10. Start a little later to allow people to arrive, but we'll still end at 10 o'clock, so it's been a long day of travel and had a good night's sleep. tomorrow morning. Breakfast is 8:30 to 9:45 at the lodge, which I think all of you've been at by now. And then we will meet here at 10 o'clock. And we meet from 10 until noon, and then our afternoon meeting is from 4 until 6. So after the noon ending of our morning session, half hour later, lunch begins at 12:30 and goes till 1:45, and then you have the afternoon. You have the afternoon until 4 o'clock when we meet here again, and then that's 4 to 6, and then dinner is 6 to 7:30. Isn't it still 6 to 7:30? And then we have the evening is from 7:30 until 10. And then finally on Sunday, the meeting here is from 9:30 to 11:30 in the morning, a little bit earlier to allow for getting our rooms ready for the ending of our weekend and the cleaning crews coming in and preparing for the next generation of people who come through. So the structure of what we thought we would do here, I'm basically going to interview Stan tonight and tomorrow morning and ask him questions about his life, his major influences, his childhood, and what it was like to grow up in Prague in the 1930s and 40s. Tomorrow morning we'll move more into the retrospective of the evolution of his thinking, of his understanding of the psyche, of his understanding of larger metaphysical, philosophical, spiritual issues, and the stages of his thinking, major intellectual influences, and so forth. And then tomorrow afternoon, we'll say a few words about his birth chart. We'll talk about much of the work that we've done over the last 30 plus years together in the cosmos and psyche area of our work together, what we've taught for a long time at California Institute of Integral Studies at our graduate school, but also many other places. And I'll also say a few words then about, in a way, like placing Stan's, the significance of Stan's contribution in a larger context, not only of psychiatry and psychology, but also in terms of what we might think of as the evolution of consciousness that has been unfolding in the modern and postmodern mind and psyche, and that Stan represents a kind of very significant shift. He's part of a much larger shift, and yet he's also a catalyst of that shift, and he's a paragon of it at the same time as he's a participant in it. So anyway, we'll talk about that. And in the evening tomorrow, we'll have a documentary, recent documentary film that was made about Stan's life. We'll show it here, and then have discussion, questions, and so forth with both Stan and Christina, who is in the documentary. And then Sunday, we will be present for what wants to happen at that point, whether it's discussions, questions, and so forth that you might particularly have after he's unfolded these different aspects of his life, things that you may be wanting to ask him, all sorts of things are possible. So that's that. Are there any questions that you might have right now in terms of the logistics of being here, especially those of you who are here for the first time at Esalen? Sam, you're not here the first time. All of our sessions are here. This is the Dan Stone or the Leonard Pavilion. The hot springs are, the baths are at the far other end of the property. Sam doesn't need to know about that, but everybody, those of you who are here for the first time, if you'd like to have a massage, it's good to book them in advance and, if possible, to time the massage around the hours that we're meeting here. It's quite possible to do. If you need towels, you can get them at the baths. They also have towels at the laundry building that you see just as you are approaching the garden on the other side of the creek. Well, if you're not familiar with what poison oak looks like, ask somebody to point it out to you. I mean, generally, you'd have to get into the off the beaten track to get into poison oak, but you don't want to get into it if you are allergic to it. And going up into the canyon, those of you who are living here right now, do you know, is the canyon open for, great, it's a magical place to go, and, you know, be cautious as you go along the creek, but it's an enchanting place, but there is poison oak that's up off the path, so just be conscious of it. So it's shiny little oak-like leaves, very beautiful. And if you're allergic to it, it's something that you'll remember afterwards. I think that's all we need to do now. Tomorrow, I'll pass around the roster to make sure that they've got all your proper contact information and things like that. So without further delay, I'd like to move into our interview here. And I'd like to, tonight I really want to give us the opportunity to hear Stan talk about his childhood and his youth, what it was like to grow up in the remarkable city of Prague in such dramatic decades as the 1930s and 40s. You know, I think of those of us who are Americans sometimes can contextualize our certain periods of our life, saying, you know, well, it was in the Eisenhower era, or I grew up in the Eisenhower era, or the Kennedy era, or during the Reagan period, it was like this. It's another thing altogether to say, well, the Nazis invaded in, when I was 7 years old or whatever, and then the communists took over when I was 17, and I was in prison. It's a whole other level of dramatic intensity to have had World War II and the Holocaust and the Cold War, to be right at, in a sense, the heart of it, and also to have such intimate experience of the Central European milieu during those decades. So I'd like to just begin, Stan, maybe if you could just say, a few words about those early years.
Something before you start questioning. You know, the work has extended to more than half a century, and it was really moving into a completely new area. I don't know if you can imagine what it was like when a tool like LSD dropped into our lab, and we had absolutely no idea, you know, what it will do, where it's going to take us.
Can everyone hear Stan okay?
No. Every session sort of brought something new, and so obviously as I was writing about it, things were changing, and we'll talk about the development, but what I would like to do, what really hasn't been done in writing, is to present a kind of a final product where I believe psychiatry and psychology should go if we take seriously the observations from what I call holotropic states, which is non-ordinary states of consciousness. And so it's very, very exciting for me to do it with Rick, because I believe that the combination of archetypal astrology and the work with non-ordinary states is really, in a way, cutting edge. Again, we have not had the chance to put it in writing. We've done it in many workshops and in the courses. So people, when they reach 80, they sort of very frequently make a statement, you know, what I have learned and where I am. So it's an opportunity to really formulate how I would see the problems now, rather than sort of the bits and pieces, you know, that sort of were published over the year.
So this weekend we'll explore a lot of things that are not already out in print and already published. Good. That's just what I enjoyed doing myself tonight with you. So tell us what it was like, the your early childhood, earliest memories, what your family situation was like, and so forth.
Well, it was somewhat complicated because I spent the first 3 years in Prague, where my parents were, you know, living together. It was really a family. And then when I was 3 years old, my grandparents from my maternal side died in a very, very rapid sequence. And then my mother moved to a place where they had business. She, for a while, was running the business, and they had to actually liquidate it before the beginning of the Second World War.
What kind of business was it?
You know, it was a kind of a small Czech town, Sears, kind of where you could buy anything from, you know, from China to nails, tools of various kinds.
General merchandise kind of store.
And so my father stayed in Prague, so basically he was coming only for the weekends. And this went for several years. Actually for a year I was sent when my mother was liquidating his business, I spent it yet another city, which is the capital of Moravia, called Brno.
You need to keep that and market close to you. Just signal us if you're not hearing him or me.
And for the time when I was with my mother, and my father was coming only for the weekends, I had a kind of a complicated female environment, where you know, we had a cook, and we had a nanny, and then there were the women who were working in this business. So I had a very complex kind of a feminine environment. And then just before the invasion, the Nazi invasion, we finally moved. To Prague, and we got the family together. And very shortly after we came to Prague, there was the invasion, and it was very, very difficult 6 years. I think it was a situation where uh, you heard about your friends ending up in concentration camps. There was a situation where a representative of Nazi Germany was assassinated in Prague, and the people who killed him managed to escape. And the Nazi response was that they would choose at random people, and every minute one person would be killed until the assassins are found. And this was broadcast in the street, so you heard the names of the people as they were being assassinated. So this was a, you know, this was a situation during the 6 years of war, and then about 5 days before the actual end of the Second World War, there was a situation where Czech people started sort of bringing out Czech banners, and the German army was coming from two sides being sort of pushed by the Anglo-Americans, and the Russians from the other side, and they moved into the streets of Prague and started killing them indiscriminately, and we were creating sort of barricades, and you know, there was a fight where a lot of people were killed by the Nazis. Then part of the German army were actually Ukrainians who moved from Ukraine, and they joined the German army, and they were actually the ones who saved Prague, but then the Russian army came and they killed all this massive army. So the last five days is really a very, very dramatic situation. I saw a lot of killing. Then when the war ended, then the Czechs turned against the Germans, and there was a big personal vendetta in the streets. So, you know, those were quite challenging years. Then we had 3 years of freedom, and then there was a communist putsch, and we went from that Nazi era into the communist era, which in some sense was more difficult than the Nazi era, because during the war, when somebody spoke Czech, you could pretty much trust that person. Whereas when we were under the Soviet influence, the divisions went through families. I mean, children were turning against parents. The children were becoming members of the Communist Party. They were reporting on parents. I was sort of personally affected in an interesting way. And when I was 17 years old, somebody who was a year older brought to school one of those chain letters where you were asked to write a letter to the American embassy asking for presenting the case of Czechoslovakia in the United Nations, asking for free elections, which were prevented by this armed putsch by the communists. And you were asked to copy it and send it to your friends. It was like a chain letter. And one of the people, schoolmates who got it, reported it, and they got the guy who distributed this this leaflet, and I think within an hour and a half they got from this guy the names of everybody who got the leaflet, which I was among them. So I came home from school, and at 1 o'clock the bell rang, and there were two men in leather coats, and they took me to a place which was known as the Four, which is the Bartholomew Street number four, and I was there for a couple of weeks, you know, being interrogated. After they took me, they sort of broke into our apartment and just basically trashed it. You know, they were looking for any kind of evidence. And so for those 2 weeks, I was together with, you know, common criminals. There were some political. Were people for political reasons, but they were also sort of thieves and pimps and so on. Pretty sort of interesting environment, and I was going through interrogation. And the method of that was that you never knew when you would be called. So at night they would come and sort of take you to a room where they would shine very, very bright lights into your eyes, and they would ask questions. There were a couple of people, you couldn't see them, and they were asking questions about my life. They were asking questions about this situation, the leaflet, and so on. And then they'd take me back to the cell, and then I didn't know whether they would come back in 20 minutes or whether I could sleep here for the rest of the night. This was a quite rough treatment. And
were they physically rough with you?
Not torture, but sort of, you know, hitting and kicking and things like that. And it was very interesting for me because the combination of sleep deprivation and you know, adrenaline and the general tension started generating kind of altered states. So it was my first experience of changed consciousness, which part of me was actually enjoying. I sort of started seeing some kind of opportunity in it. And I recognized later when I had actual sessions, you know, that I recognized that state of consciousness. So then from these 2 weeks of interrogation, I was put into prison where I stayed for 3.5 months. And then I went to trial, and during the interrogation I basically was maintaining a story, saying that these schoolmates sort of handed me a piece of paper, but it was already end of the break, and the bell was ringing, that I just put it into my pocket, and I really didn't read it, and I sort of maintained that kind of story. And then I was acquitted for lack of evidence.
Did you, when you were in prison, they allowed you, after the 2 weeks interrogation, they allowed you two books to read, is that right?
Yeah, I've chosen Shakespeare and English dictionary.
He had a choice of, you could choose two books that you could have, the whole time, and he chose the collected works of Shakespeare and an English dictionary. And one of the reasons I think they were giving you such a hard time with the interrogation was that you had visited the U.S. Embassy a number of times, right?
Yeah, I had sort of applied for a scholarship, which was being offered to finish the, you know, what would be the level of high school in the United States. And so I visited the American Embassy a few times, you know, checking how things were, and also going through an examination in English and so on. And what happened is that one of these leaflets was given to a man who was working in a publishing business, which was specifically for the National Socialist Party, which was the main rival of the communists. And he somehow put it into the machine and printed a large number of that. And when they were interrogating, and I was somebody who had connection with the American Embassy, they must have had a camera there or some other way of knowing who was going there. So they were basically trying to prove that actually this was organized by the American Embassy, and that I was somehow the connection. So this is why, you know, so it's a little tougher than it would be.
I find it interesting, though, that given that the two books that you chose were the dictionary in English and those are two, and to get the collected works of Shakespeare is probably one of the two that I would choose too. You weren't veiling your interest in English culture at that point.
Yeah, what was interesting later, I was guiding people, you know, when there were visitors in our institute. I was doing sightseeing with them and sort of showing them things in Prague. And, I had sort of expressions, you know, Halfian and Halberd and sort of.
Shakespearean words that aren't used that much anymore.
That the visitors have kind of difficulties sometimes.
I'd be interested in hearing about the early interest that you had in childhood in animals and also in art, and the combination that you made.
Sort of one of the things that I was entertaining myself in prison was to make sculptures of bread. You kind of put some water and bread together, and you create this mass, and then it dries, and you can paint it. So I think it all ended on fire. I don't think we had any of them left. Mm. I brought some of them to.
They were animals.
So, you know, one thing that I would like to add also, there's a very interesting pattern in my life where things get very difficult, and then there's suddenly, you know, something happened and the situation changed. So one of those things was that when I came to this prison and they pushed me into the cell, I hear, Stan, Standard, which was the Czech version of it. And it happened that there was my friend who had been there already, I think, 17 months or so. And because he was, get some contact with a CIA agent. And so he was like a long timer there, kind of a jailbird. and he was the like the head of the cell. And so he kind of took me under his wings, so I didn't go through the kind of equivalent of hazing that was happening in, you know, in prison and so on. And then I was when I was released from prison, I had to go through examinations because I lost one quarter of a year there, and then I did the examination, and then they transferred me to another school because of, I was like, you know, big bad influence on the schoolmates, so they put me to a school which had a very dedicated communist as a principal. And the school had a very, very low level, and so I...
You mean of like educational...
Educational levels rigor. Compared to the one that I came from. And so I... when I graduated, I actually got the gold medal of the communist president, Gotthard. And then they discovered this this principal of that school had suffered a heart attack. So at the time when I was transferred there, he wasn't there, and he somehow missed that.
That you were
that I was there,
president.
And then would have, you know, allowed me to, with that kind of background, to get this gold medal. And then afterwards, during the vacation, I was working in building a dam, and there were my friends, a group of my friends were there, and our work was to basically build a road around this dam. So take stone from one side and then put it on a wheelbarrow to get to the other. And the only way they could control it is by, you know, getting the number of the wheelbarrows from you. And then every couple of months they use trigonometry, sort of how much of the rock was missing. And so it was very easy to cheat. And then also, my friends who were decided to be members of the Communist Party, and so somehow at the end of this, they knew that I was in a somewhat precarious situation, and so they suggested that I would get like a special award for achievement, you know, in this manual labor, demonstrating kind of my relationship with the working class. And so then finally, when I applied for medical school, there was this very kind of confusing situation where I had a kind of a prison background, but then I had this gold medal from the communist president, and then I had this special appreciation for the work I had done on this dam. And so they finally decided that they would actually accept me, which was, you know, pretty questionable.
So without these little
so it kind of
accidents, you
from a very, very difficult situation, suddenly a series of sort of.
If you hadn't gone to medical school, you wouldn't become a psychiatrist. The LSD wouldn't have arrived. The whole, all the things that we know about your life here wouldn't have unfolded.
And I think you can mention something when you do the.
Yeah,
the birth chart.
Yeah.
That happened many, many times in my life. It's a very precarious situation.
Yeah, like when you're arrested or held up at the Canada-U.S. border with a van full of psychedelics.
Not
completely full, but.
I was moving to Esalen from Baltimore. And my brother came with a U-Haul and he took my library and some other things temporarily to Canada. And we went to shipped to Nova Scotia, and I drove it and picked up the stuff from my brother. So there was my psychedelic library, you know, Leary and Rindas and all those things. And there happened to be some ampules, you know, of LSD, and there was also some grass which they found. And so this was also spent a day, and then it all sort of got resolved.
They just let you go at a certain point. They decided you were not going to be indicted for this.
Yeah, it was a. There were these ampules of Sandoz LSD, but the it was called Delicit, but it was sort of washed off the name. And so I said that it was dihydroergotamine, which is another kind of a preparation of lysergic acid, which is used officially. So anyway, after spending a day, we find out where it's going.
Was this in Detroit?
Yeah.
The same experience for Harvard roommates. It was a couple of hours where you kind of look at your whole life passing before your eyes, and then they, fortunately, my girlfriend made friends with the leader of the investigation while we were getting strip searched, the guys were, and then when we came out, he asked us. I mean, they didn't find the LSD or the mescaline, unfortunately, but they found a little bit of hash and grass and a pipe, and they asked us where this came from. And anyway, we didn't want any one of us to take. They asked us whose is this, and at first we said, oh, it's just a hitchhiker's, and then he pressed me more. I said, well, none of us is going to take, wants any one of us to take it for all, take the blame for all of us. And this guy who'd been having this nice conversation with my girlfriend about his daughter's wedding that was about to happen, he took the pipe and he threw it in the waste basket and said, you guys go and be good. And that was it. It was a similar kind of thing, where right at that same border.
But in our case, the VW camper was shipped, you know, from Bremerhaven to Nova Scotia, so somebody must have
packed the stuff.
Yeah, slept in it probably during the time when it was shipped, and must have left in it. But I was in a precarious situation because I didn't have American citizenship yet. You know, I don't know what would have happened to me.
Well, let's go back to the certain aspects of your childhood that I'd be interested in hearing the artistic impulse that took over so early, and talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, the situation was that I started reading very early, like between the age of 4 and 5. I had older cousins who were just learning to read, and I was very kind of competitive. I couldn't stand, you know, that they were doing something, sort of entering a world that for me was closed. And so I learned very, very early, and became particularly interested in reading about animals. I was fascinated by, and it's not in the way I would be now. I had a fantasy of becoming a hunter, hunting lions. 6 years old, my parents gave me 24 volumes of what was called Grand Slam Animals. I spent a lot of time reading that. And I started drawing the animals. When we had classes of biology, the teacher asked me to come to the blackboard and draw those animals for the class. And then I discovered Walt Disney, and that was a tremendous revelation for me. It was about a block from where we lived, was a movie theater where they were showing these two-hour programs of cartoons, Silly Symphonies and so on, Popeye and Felix the Cat and so on. And this was like it used to be here in the United States when I came, that once you are in the movie theater, you don't have to leave. You could sort of stay. So I would sometimes be there like from 2 to 8, watching it and again learning to draw all the Disney characters. And then there was another artist called Sekora who published a series of books of adventures of Freddy the Ant, which is kind of an ant with a tie, a polka dot tie. And he had all these adventures, sort of his enemies and friends in the world of insects. So I started drawing these personified insects in the whole comic strips. And when I was 10 years old, I had the first publication, which is a story, kind of a hero's journey of a little beetle who eats the cake that was for the whole family and gets kicked out, and there's all these adventures, meets another friend, and then towards the end they sort of made a boat made of half of walnut, and they get into a storm, and the storm brings them just within a short distance from their home, so kind of a hero's journey. And actually, one of the enemies was a spider. So it was my the first encounter with the second Matrix. Kind of
those of you who've seen Stan's slideshow that accompanies the death rebirth process in the perinatal matrices will recall he's kind of a connoisseur of different states of hell and crisis, but also there's he has lots of spider imagery, and as a kind of symbol of the devouring mother or the certain parts of the perinatal journey. And so I find it fascinating with both your art and your artistic imagination that started coming then, but also in your, I think you've got some images that you brought here that shows some of the your childhood drawings. Can we look at them now? Is that a good time?
Sure, we can. It's a series that goes then.
You could introduce the later ones too, as we get to them.
Yeah, okay. Can I just give you a sign?
Or I can do it.
So the first two slides, that's that the comic strip that was published when I was 10 years old. And these are three parts. The third part is missing. You have lost somewhere. So you just see the first two.
So that has to warm up
for just a minute. With it? Oh, we have to. Can we turn down the light? showing him eating the cake, and then the father kicks him out, and then he sees this spider web and another beetle sort of, you know, as a victim of the spider, and so he rescues him. And that's the, you know, they become friends, and they build, this ship, and the ship gets into a storm, and then the last part was the homecoming, the kind of a hero's journey.
So how old were you at this point?
Let me see, they didn't say. This was 14, I think. 13, 14. And so this was then, the next stage was I was publishing, creating a class journal, you know, that came out in regular intervals. So this would have been 45, so that's 14. So this is just a sampling of those pictures from it.
What is the title?
What's the title?
Oh, you know, there were the year there were two classes. There was one was A, the other one was B, and so it's a kind of a arch is a. Translated. It refers to the fact that we were this
subsection of the class.
Subsection of the class, and Archico is like something that you can do with A in Czech. So these are, you know, different schoolmates. They had nicknames. So each of them has a. Is represented in a certain way. And then this was a little later, I think a couple years later, where I became fascinated by the pre-Columbian art, the Mayans and the Aztecs, and this early Incas, and I was sort of painting in the style of those cultures, and kind of my own variations of race.
In retrospect, do you think that you're kind of tapping into like a kind of you know, and the collective unconscious and the kind of ancestral or historical cultural complex, as it were, that you're tuning into aesthetically.
Well, there was also a situation where my mother took me. She was she became very interested in Paul Branton's writing, the British philosopher and writer who spent some time in Arunachala with Shiramana Maharshi, and then also in Egypt. And he wrote the kind of books that were popularizing the Indian philosophy and some of the ancient Egyptian. So I became fascinated by that. And then also the pre-Columbian culture and Atlantis and those kinds of things. And then when I started doing psychedelics, it turned out that those were sort of archetypes in my unconscious. It was so close to my consciousness that it generated this really intense interest in these in these cultures. This group around Brampton was also interested in Aurobindo. This is where I first found, you know, Indian philosophy and Indian mythology. But I was seeing it as kind of an intellectual interest. But then, for example, the Hindu mythologies came alive for me. You know, I didn't know that you can encounter Shiva or Kali, or that you can experience yourself as Shiva. But if I look at my whole development, I was also attracted, I was always attracted to things that in some sense are anticipated by my future experiences and interests of a different kind.
Yeah, it's like what Hillman calls the his acorn theory.
Yeah, very much so.
If you are to, Louis Armstrong is going to become the greatest trumpet player for the birth of jazz, and he therefore feels drawn. He's given a trumpet out of the blue as a 12-year-old orphan in New Orleans, and the experiences that you need to have, you're somehow given openings that draw you towards it and to actualize what is potential in you. And in these cases, it seems like, when you think about how much Indian philosophy and ancient Egyptian myth and religion and culture, and then pre-Columbian, Aztec and Mayan and Inca became of profound, not just kind of intellectual interest, but they actualize themselves in your own experience. It's as if you were drawn like a magnet to these streams that you will then have later this opportunity to experience much more fully.
It was almost like a hound, sort of finding sort of bits and pieces of something that sort of it's leading you in a kind of a specific direction. I know, very, very powerful fascination by Egypt, and it turns out that one of my most important past life experiences was
in Egypt.
Egypt, yeah.
Well, since we're about to go to the medical, I see you've got medical school duels coming up here. Why don't you share the this kind of turning point that happened where you were planning on being a going into animation professionally, and then someone gave you a book.
Yeah, this was a time when I sort of my interest shifted from Disney to a Czech artist whose name was Trnka, very difficult to pronounce. But he was amazing. He won a lot of gold medals in Cannes and other places, and with more serious subjects like Midsummer Night's Dream or Pushkin's Fairy Tales or Slavic mythology and so on. And I wanted to get involved in animated movies, and I had an interview with him in discussion, and he kind of encouraged it, and I was, ready to start my career. When a friend of mine lent me introductory lectures, the psychoanalysis, Freud, and I started reading it in the evening, and I couldn't stop, and went through the whole book, and within a week I decided I'm gonna let the cartoons, the animated movies go, and I will become a psychoanalyst. Now I see that, ultimately I didn't get very far from the animated movies,
with the psychedelics,
but it was a very, Freud was just, it was another, another one of those elements that I instantly recognized and sort of pursued.
And so that's why you
the things were kind of coming together from different sources.
Now, would this have been the year after you were in prison? Would you have been 18 then, or?
Well, after prison, then making the decision,
So that
when I mentioned it,
1950, would that have been?
Yeah, the situation of being accepted, actually, which was not, quite sure if it would happen. So this was very shortly after being released from the plan. I had another year, actually.
So that was 1950.
Within a year, yeah.
So then these are, I guess, some doodles here.
Yeah, this is I was, listening to medical lectures, and so these were either things related to the medical lectures or something that I was reading at the time. So this was a professor of anatomy who loved to point to various kind of atavistic features, like we still have musculus levator caude, which is the remnant of the muscles that move the tail, and so on. So these are all these different things that he was pointing out. He just loved the atavistic aspects of the human anatomy,
which you could say you do psychologically.
This was Paracelsus, creating homunculus, artificial human being. This was a professor of physiology, specialized in kidneys, for the lord of Silurian waters. We're talking about the fact that we find in for example, in the amnion, like remnants of the primeval ocean, and so on. So this was Darwin, reading Darwin. Variation under domestication.
Did you put this, the English, in later years?
No, I did, because I was reading it in English, so
okay. Cool.
I was using the English terms for that. Yeah, this was a professor of chemistry who was very kind of a challenging. We had to learn all these combinations of a certain group of substances, and so it reflects the kind of confusion,
So you would have been about 21 years old, and this is 1952. Yeah. And did any of the professors see their own self-portrait, their own portraits?
Not in this one, but in the class journal. What would be high school? We call it gymnasium. So those did. This is the same professor of anatomy. This is professor of physiology, and they had an argument about the Czech name for the cortex, whether you say Kura or Kora. So he has a Pavlovian dog there, and the guy has a fetus in formaldehyde. Worth reading Nietzsche.
Do you want to say a little bit about your interest in German culture, with the Wagner and Nietzsche and so forth?
Yeah, and during the 6 years when we the Nazi occupation, there was an effort to Germanize Europe, expose other countries to German culture. So we had 6 hours of German every week, and German literature, and German history, and so on. And every Saturday we had to go to see an opera. My mother was a concert musician, so we had sort of a lot of interest in music, and I found myself fascinated with it, just, you know, which is not very, very difficult, but I, in spite of the fact that this was an indoctrination, it was sort of forced, I really got very, very much involved in music. And one of the things that we saw there was the Nibelungen Ring, which just was going, was being shown in San Francisco. And it was quite an amazing performance where they actually brought live horses on the stage. And particularly the end of Valkyrie and the Götterdämmerung, the fire, was, the power was, of the archetypes.
Was this in San Francisco or in Prague that the horses came right on stage and everything?
No, this was in Prague.
Uh-huh.
No, what they did for Seattle, they do these silly experiments. They, in Seattle, they put the Valkyries on a merry-go-round on the board horses and so on. And here it is, when they were doing the ring in San Francisco, now they put it in the time of the California Gold Rush. And so their Wotan was kind of telephone. I was using a telephone. It was like an office somewhere in downtown San Francisco. It was Valhalla. But this was very, very powerful, and I just became fascinated by Wagner and sort of listened to it with looking at the librettos and the way Wagner was working with the leitmotifs and so on.
And this sort of
this became
in the 1940s. Is that when that happened?
1943, maybe 44.
Was there 12, 13? I remember when you and Christina were the very first months that you were together. You had a cabin or a small home in Palo Colorado Canyon, and I remember you sharing with me that one of the things that you were doing in the evening is listening to Wagner together, and that I could tell that you were sharing something with her that was really, from your most precious life's experiences.
Yeah, that was it's a very, very powerful influence, and kind of interesting that it came, in a context which was very, very unlikely to inspire you.
Yeah, it must have been quite a paradox that you'd be holding. On the one hand, Wagner was, Hitler's favorite composer, and it was being used as a kind of cultural juggernaut by the Nazis, and Nietzsche had been appropriated by the Nazis and distorted terribly in order to serve their ideologies. But at the same time, you're recognizing the magnitude of the artistic achievement that Wagner had done and the intellectual achievement of Nietzsche.
It was also concerts. It was not just opera. So we also went to concerts and also
Beethoven and Weber.
Something similar happened then later with the Russians. Again, there was a tendency to bring in sort of Russian culture to Czechoslovakia.
Oh yeah, there's in Zarathustra where the monkey is on his back. Yeah. So
and this was it's called the Twilight of the Idols, I think.
Twilight of the Götterdämmerung.
Götterdämmerung is the I think Twilight of the Idols. And this is the story of Eloise,
Oh, yeah. That's the father.
They sort of they caught the in flagrante. Spending an evening in a bar, in a crime bar. Memory of that.
A lot of your human beings have a rather id-like appearance. You know, they're very biological, Darwinian.
This I became fascinated by Chinese. And actually it was a footnote in Freud, when he's talking about the dream work, the dreams just work with images, and he uses the reference to Chinese pictograms. And so I studied Chinese for a couple of years.
So you were. At that point, you had already been studying Sanskrit because of your interest in Indian philosophy, and you knew Czech, German, and English, and then Latin and Greek from school as well.
Yeah, so I was reading
Moses and Monotheism.
Moses and Monotheism, yeah.
So
it was kind of an initiation of Moses in the Egyptian.
That's Freud's last major work, and in his Freud's thesis is that Moses was actually an Egyptian.
The San Bernard dogs that were used in the Alps to rescue people. This was actually true. They were carrying rum when they find some people. This was from Rambo. St. George.
This is like Don Quixote.
This is
that's a very good rendering.
No, this is where then psychedelics came into my life. It was a major turning point, of course. I have just a few.
This is Albert Hoffman.
This is a photograph from the time when Albert Hoffman discovered LSD, and this must have been like probably 15 years ago. More 17 years ago, maybe. This Anita, his wife. You recognize Christina there. And when we were there at this time, Martina Hoffman and Roberto Venosa, two great, great visionary artists, were visiting, just happened to be visiting. This was Albert's favorite toy, the music box, which had a shape. This was from Russian folklore, the cottage, Baba Yaga on chicken leg.
Was that the same as Mussorgsky used for in pictures at an exhibition?
Mussorgsky, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is one where Rick was present, and also Rebecca was in this as well. This is where we brought Hans Rudolf Giger, who was the one who got the Academy Award for Alien. This was my last book that hopefully will be published sometime soon.
I think of this, the three of you together as, on the one hand, G. Giger represents kind of like the darkest side of LSD experience, and Albert Hoffman represents that, you know, he's got this kind of St. John's mysticism, mystical Goethe and Johannine version of LSD as a mystical opening. And Stan kind of carries the tension and the balance between the underworld and the overworld, celestial. Yes.
Yeah, we became friends, Hans Rudi Giger and myself, and his current wife, Carmen, did the whole training to holotropic breathwork, facilitator, and so we did two of our training modules in Greer in Giger's museum. And in the first one, Albert was still alive. So we